Well, thanks very much, Steve, and thanks to AE for hosting this event and to all of y'all for all of the work that you do in helping to drive this industry forward. I have to say that it's one of the kind of best things about being in this space, which is working with and being able to interact with a really dynamic group of people. My focus is at the intersection of a couple really interesting topics around the demands that we place on water and energy. And so got started in 2009, co-founding the company Natel Energy with my brother to commercialize a new hydropower technology. And we decided to actually locate here in California. We're based in Alameda because California has this very interesting opportunity around that nexus of energy and water. So you might ask, why hydro? And quite frankly, when we get started, you wouldn't have been alone at all, and probably still today you wouldn't be alone in asking that question. In particular, it's an industry which is decades old. There was a lot of skepticism around whether there was any room for innovation, and what could we actually do that was new? So when you think of hydro, the reason why people have that reaction is because conventional hydro is generally constrained by the fact that it tends to come with it, under the conventional way we've developed, with a pretty significant negative environmental and social impact footprint. But that comes from the fact that conventional technology is optimized around pressure, which leads us to build large dams. So we saw that as an opportunity for innovation, whereby if we could build a cost-effective and efficient low-pressure large flow device, we would be able to flip the development model for hydro on its head. So that's what we set out to do. And 5 years later, with some pretty critical support from the Department of Energy, we're now releasing our first product family with turbines going up to 1 megawatt in size. And these are aimed at a first market, which we call small hydro, where the projects are kind of 1 to 30 megawatts in size. And in the United States, what that is really focused on is the retrofit of existing water infrastructure. For example, we have projects here in California, in Arizona, and in Oregon, where we're retrofitting existing irrigation canal drops. And then we have a couple projects on the East Coast, in Maine and Connecticut, where we're retrofitting low head or relatively low existing dams. To give you a feel for what this could be in the United States, the DOE has identified about 7 gigawatts of this kind of potential. There are over 50,000 existing non-power water structures less than 50 feet tall. We have a lot of that here in the US. Earlier this year, on the international front, we actually made our first foray and now have our first projects lining up in Chile. So it's been a pretty exciting progress. We're excited to be able to bring to market this first technology. We're really happy to be based here in California because we actually think, kind of bringing it back here to the state, that this state really has an incredibly interesting opportunity in terms of what we face and being in the needs, the demands that we place on our water infrastructure and the need to invest in that in order to support the overall our overall population levels. And this opportunity to deliver some new, reliable, and predictable, relatively cheap, renewable energy. So on that point, I'd like to move to introduce, and I'm honored to introduce the next part of our program today. And we'll hear from two individuals who have really shown tremendous leadership in addressing these issues and are committed to finding solutions to our state's climate and energy challenges. Mary Nichols is the chairwoman of the California Air Resources Board, which, as probably we all know, is charged with implementing the state's landmark AB 32 program. She's held that position since 2007, and we're very pleased to have her here today to share her perspectives on how California is going to meet our 2050 goals. And then we'll also hear from Tom Steyer, who is a businessman and investor, co-founder of AEE, and as all, again, many of us know, was very active in helping to defeat Proposition 23, and then in 2012 was very active in his support for the passage of Proposition 39. The success of both of those efforts was critical in affirming the public support for the path that this state is on to address our climate and energy challenges. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce and thank you.
So actually, this is not a chance for you to hear my views. This is a chance for you to hear Mary Nichols' views, which are far more informed and interesting than anything that I'd have to say. So I'd like to thank Gia for introducing us. I would also like to thank our lead sponsor. It's incredibly how important our lead sponsor is Beneficial State Bank. And my thanks to that incredible institution. It's a coincidence that the CEO is my wife. That has nothing to do with it. But let me say, she is the best bank CEO in the United States of America.
And you should know.
And I did ask her what before you are going to hear from Mary, but I said how to my wife Catherine, how should I introduce Mary? And she said, well, I think it's important to point out that having women in positions of power is something that is very good for all of us. So let me just say. So all kidding aside, I thought I'd start by asking Mary a question about AB 32, which is we all know is in existence, and asking her, in terms of the cap and trade system that we have and that is in place, it's not fully in place, is there anything, how do you feel it's doing, first of all? How would you grade it? Is it succeeding in what you wanted it to do when it was devised? And if you were giving advice to someone else in 2004 or 2005, what would you advise them to do differently?
First of all, we actually are being asked to give advice to people on a regular basis because we get a steady stream of visitors from China, from Mexico, South Korea, various provinces and states around the world that are looking at the possibility of cap and trade, despite what you may have read, although California is today the only complete and fully successfully functioning cap and trade program. There are a number of jurisdictions in North America that are now considering this, particularly in light of the Obama administration's proposal under Rule 111D of the Clean Air Act to begin to ratchet down on greenhouse gas emissions from existing power plants. So there's an incentive out there now for people to take another look at this versus other possible strategies for meeting the reduction goals. As far as California's cap and trade program is going, I'd give us a pretty high mark. I'm a tough grader, but I cannot think of anything that has gone wrong, which is always the first thing as a person in government that you have to ask yourself is, you know, have we experienced any setbacks? Have we had any disasters? Have we had to cover up any terrible mistakes that we made and flaws in the program design? And the answer to that would be no. Carbon prices have stayed pretty close to the floor price that we set, which presumably is something that some people who were trading or wanted to be trading in carbon allowances may not be happy about. They might prefer a market that had risen a little bit more. On the other hand, from the Resources Board's perspective, the fact that companies that need allowances because they're covered by the program are able to buy them at somewhere close to the price that we had set as a floor level seems pretty good. And at an average price somewhere around $11.50, again, that's not enough to cover the full social cost of carbon, but it is a far cry from the European price, which has been much, much lower. And that's because we learned from their example and did not over-allocate allowances in the beginning. So that's kind of a long answer, but I would say if you set out to do a cap and trade program to begin with, if you decided that's the policy tool you're going to use, that the program that we have designed and implemented has gone quite well.
So there is obviously a big change coming up and a challenge coming up, which is that transportation fuels are scheduled to come under the cap 1/1/15.
Correct.
And there has been talk in Sacramento between a group of lawmakers and presumably some industry representatives to try to delay by a couple of years taking transportation fuels under the cap. So I would say to you two things. One is there a reason for transportation fuels to be treated differently from other industries? And is the first question. And the second question is, delaying, what would be the effect of delaying this by a couple of years?
Well, first of all, the program was designed from the beginning to include transportation fuels. But we started with the largest industrial emitters first because it was a defined universe of around 400 or so entities that we knew We had issues from the very beginning that we had to go through in terms of how to allocate their allowances, getting the auctions up and running, making sure our tracking system for allowances was absolutely airtight, enforcement was in place, et cetera. And so we needed some time before we brought the fuels in. Fuels covers a much larger range of entities. It's a lot more allowances that are going to be in the system. And that's part of why it's necessary that we bring the fuels under the cap, is so that we will bring those additional allowances into the cap and trade program. As the cap comes down, which is what it's designed to do in order to get the reductions in greenhouse gas and other emissions, we have to make sure that there's an adequate supply of allowances out there. And by putting the fuels into the cap, we make that much more possible. The other thing is, and to answer the question about what would happen if you were to delay, there are many companies that have made investments in allowances and in products that are designed to reduce the carbon content of fuels, alternative fuels, people who are bringing in electricity as a transportation fuel, natural gas, et cetera, who would be set back considerably. If we were to delay, it would create a sense of uncertainty about the market, which would deter investment and send a signal that perhaps they might escape altogether. So if you want to run, and I'm treading on your turf here, but it's what everything I have been told is that if you want to run any kind of a successful market-based program, you have to set your terms out long enough, make this thing sufficiently robust and reliable that people will feel confident that they can make investments in that market. And that's what we're trying to do.
And let me say that my co-chair in NOON 23 and on Prop 39, George Shultz, always said to me, when you're making policy, Tom, you have to make it unchangeable so everyone can plan and you can never waver, because they have to make hard decisions about spending money. And for them to do that, they have to be confident in the framework that they're going to be working, which is Mary's point. Well, let me ask you, you said earlier that the EPA's rule 111D about the carbon emissions from existing power plants is giving the leadership of California a chance to talk to other states and explain what our program is. Obviously, carbon isn't a problem that can be solved by California by itself. So between 111D and the West Coast Collaborative, the attempt to get to hook up with British Columbia, Washington, and Oregon, how do you see your role beyond California? How do you see it on a regional basis, or a national basis, or an international basis?
Well, in terms of electricity markets, which is where we first started really in this program, we are part of one large interconnected grid in the Western United States. And designing a program for one state only, although I think we were able to do it with some degree of credibility, required a lot of careful machinations in order not to disrupt electricity markets or have a disproportionate impact on California consumers. So we've been conscious from the very beginning of the need to try to broaden this program, to get more players into it, both in order to overall have a bigger impact, because California's goal has always been to be a leader, not to be an island, and also because from our perspective, since we have a much cleaner grid within the state of California, cleaner generation mix in our state, and we import from a lot of other places, if we can convince other states to take advantage of that, in effect, cleaner baseline, as they now have to move into cleaning up the sources in their states, we can all do better together. So in effect, California would be helping these other states to green up their energy supply, but give them a little extra time and a little bit of extra resources potentially to do that with. Now, this requires planning together, working together in a way that we have not ever done before, certainly around climate, which is a word that in some states can't even be uttered by elected officials. But what we are hearing is that even the states that are most adamantly opposed to the EPA rulemaking, the coal-dependent states such as Wyoming, who are suing to invalidate the EPA rule, are also pragmatically looking at how they could comply if they had to. And they are all committed to the notion that a market-based program is the right way to go.
So I don't know how many people in the room know, but Mary was really the person who made the 54 miles per gallon rule happen. Honestly, individually, this woman who's sitting here is the person who made it happen. So it's not the first time that you will have acted outside the state of California.
That's true.
But let me ask you this.
That's true.
Does it, California leadership, as a Californian who travels outside the state sometimes, yes, people look at us and we're the most populous state, and they sometimes think that we're a little full of ourselves. Does that get in your way at all when you go to Washington or Oregon or Idaho or Montana?
Sure. If we were to go out on the road and say, we're California, just pay attention to us and do it our way and all will be well, that would not be a very effective strategy, for sure. I think what's given us a new opportunity to engage with some of our sister states within the United States, every one of which has its own CEO and its own legislature and its own electricity regulator and its own, you know, pride in the way they do things, is this idea that EPA is going to be imposing regulations. And so if there are sufficient incentives to work together across state lines, because we can maybe do things a little bit more efficiently and have more control over our own fate that way, that's a good reason for states to want to work together. It's different internationally. I think it's fair to say that in many parts of the world, California is looked to as the golden example of a place that other people would like to copy because it's a beautiful state. They've all seen California in pictures, if not in reality, and know that it's a very prosperous state. And in the case of people who are involved in any kind of environmental regulation, they also know that we had a terrible air pollution problem here for many years, and we confronted it and we were able to deal with it, and our air is cleaner as a result of it, and our people are healthier, and our businesses are thriving still. And in fact, probably if we hadn't taken it on, if we hadn't had the battles that we had with the oil companies and the auto industry early on, this place would not be what it is today. So in that sense, California is recognized as an example that people want to look to.
What about in terms of the attempt to hook up with British Columbia, Washington, and Oregon? Would that make a significant... Do you think that that would be a huge change for that province and those two states to adopt something like the one, the system that we have? And would it be similar to the 9 states in the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative in the Northeast?
Well, you're referring to the Pacific Coast Collaborative, yeah, which is an ongoing agreement among the 3 states on the Pacific Coast and the province of British Columbia to work together on a variety of carbon-related mm-hmm. issues. And the governors have all agreed that they want to put a price on carbon, but they're not all in agreement about exactly how they want to do it. So the governor of Washington, Governor Inslee, is very interested in a cap-and-trade program. British Columbia has a carbon tax, and Oregon is still thinking about it. And I think this is an example of where we feel that California should not be trying to dictate the exact means by which states try to achieve these goals, that if these other states want to work with us across state lines on some of the policies that are related to pricing carbon and on other things that they've indicated, like creating better markets for electric vehicles, like stronger building efficiency standards and appliance standards and so forth, that the fact that they choose a different way of pricing carbon shouldn't necessarily stand in the way of our being able to create some linkages. And it would send a very powerful message, right, I think, that the entire West Coast was in some kind of an agreement on how to do this.
Okay, so let me ask you a question. So we're talking about the results of AB 32, and we have goals through 2020, which is to get back to 1990 levels of emissions, but we don't have goals beyond 2020.
Correct.
What has to happen, and what do you think? We have goals for 2050, but there's nothing between 2020 and 2050. What do you think the process will be for determining those interim goals, and do you have any sense of what they should look like?
Sure. Well, the state energy agencies, which include the Public Utilities Commission, the Energy Commission, and the California Independent Systems Operator, all of whom have been here at this conference earlier today, have been working jointly on a modeling exercise that's going to help us, I think, look at the costs and feasibility of various different scenarios for setting a midpoint and that will get us to 2050. So basically the issues that we're wrestling with are how to use the policies and tools that are already in place today, make them work better together, pick a midterm target, because we know that 2050 is too hard to think about. There are too many things that are going to happen between now and then that we can't yet fully understand. But that if we can pick a target somewhere between, you know, 2030 and 2040, and then try to optimize, we could probably do that. We could probably know enough, at least, to set a pretty firm number that we would then be able to stick to. And the biggest challenge, actually, from ARB's perspective, is that in addition to meeting our climate goals, we have an obligation to meet federal health standards as well for air pollution. And we still have in our state substantial areas and very large population centers in the South Coast and in the San Joaquin Valley where air does not meet federal standards. So somewhere between now and 2032, we're going to have to hit that target as well. We have to do that legally. There are sanctions at the federal level if we don't. But it's also, I think, a very strong moral obligation on our part to focus on the well-being of our citizens. So it turns out that it's actually somewhat more challenging in terms of reductions that you've got to get from combustion sources, meaning trucks, buses, trains, planes, cars, and all the industries that burn fuel. That challenge is actually somewhat harder than it is to actually move on a straight line towards 2050 for greenhouse gases. So it's a double challenge, but we've got to do both.
So you're really suggesting that it wouldn't necessarily be a 2030 date, that it could be longer.
It might be a year or two, either way would make a difference. And that's one of the things that we're trying to understand is given the policies, the trajectories that we're already on, the mixes and matches of things like greater penetration of electric vehicles, if we get the $25,000 300-mile EV here within 10 years, that makes a big difference in comparison with a different scenario. So those are the kinds of things that we're trying to kind of mix and match and see how we can optimize this approach, understanding that we don't have full control over all pieces of the puzzle or even total knowledge of what technology is going to do for us. But if we can see what we need to do to get there, I think we can put some numbers on the table and then get there. Now, the Air Resources Board, we believe, legally has the power under AB 32 to set that midterm target, but obviously it would be better if it were something that was agreed to jointly with the legislature and other broad policies that we're going to be trying to implement as well. So our hope is that once we're finished with our internal planning and reveal all of this to the public sometime this fall, that we'll be able to engage in a broader public debate and get support for the next big step forward.
If it were going to be perfect, when do you think that would you try and come up with some kind of projection and a date and a target?
When would that happen?
Would you do it? I mean, do you need 2 years or do you do it the date? Do you do it in 2020 or do you do it in 2018 or
no,
does
mean,
it matter?
I I think it matters now just because of the pushback that we're getting, you know, frankly, on our existing program coming from the fuels industry. It would be helpful if we were in a position to go out with a forward projection earlier rather than later.
So you were talking about the impact of technology, the fact that that people are going to innovate, they're going to do research, they're going to develop new products, and it's completely unpredictable because the product that people are going to come up with in 2026 may be dependent on the product that you never knew people were going to come up with in 2024.
Correct.
So when you think about this, what do you think the role of the people sitting in this room is, the business executives who are trying to come up with the clean products? And in particular, is there a what is their political role as well as their economic role?
Well, there's a couple of different questions. First of all, the most important role clearly is to keep on inventing great new products and finding ways to solve our problems. From a political perspective, I can understand why a company like the one that we were just hearing about earlier, you know, started by a brother and sister that's, you know, doing well but really just getting started, is not in a position to hire a flotilla of lawyers, lobbyists, and PR firms to influence government decision making. But it is still somewhat shocking to me how little recognized it is in Sacramento that we have the level of investment, the caliber of people and companies working on this problem in our state because of AB 32 and our other environmental policies that we have today. And I'm not in a position to really advise how this should change, but it seems to me that there have to be more effective ways that we could hear from some of the people that are represented out here in the audience today. I'm well aware of the fact that when AB 32 was passed in the first place back in 2000, was going through the legislature 2005, 2006, the Silicon Valley leadership group and companies from Silicon Valley made a big difference in that legislation passing. I'm not going to downplay the role of the environmental community. They were very important as well. But I think without that other voice having been heard, the legislation would never have passed in the first place. I think it's time to sort of revive that discussion because I don't think we should take it for granted that the political will is always there to continue on with programs like this. Whenever resistance sets in, some new group of people decides that they want to try to start a campaign to slow it down or change it, then these battles are not won permanently. They keep on having to be refought, unfortunately.
So when you think about what the people in this room, you look at the predominance of venture money and startups in clean tech in California, and you also think about the sophistication of the people at CalISO, for instance, mm-hmm. who I know are here, and also the very progressive leadership that elected officials and appointed officials in the state of California have taken. How do you think about the other parts of the United States where, as you said, climate is something that it's very hard to mention in public, and where obviously we are tied to them as well. What is the relationship we can have, the most productive relationship we can have, where we feel as if we've progressed very far in technical and business and legislative expertise, and yet somehow people are fighting very hard to not hear that?
Well, I think what you're getting at is this, again, the issue of how can you run a climate program in one state? And the answer is you can't, certainly not forever. It has to be moving other people to join. I think the question might a little bit underrate the importance of what one of my fellow state commissioners refers to as the brag and steal phenomenon that states engage in. We all like to brag about what a great job we're doing promoting industry in our own states, and we all like to steal ideas from each other, and this is a good thing. And I do feel that having a successful program in California is something that other states will look at. Maybe not everybody has an appetite to go all the way to an AB 32, but there are many state governors who are talking about how their state is going to be the biggest and best market for electric vehicles, or their state is going to have more wind power, whatever. And so that's fine. We can compete with each other around some of those very desirable technology innovations and move them gradually in the direction of doing things that will also reduce their overall contribution to global warming.
So you were telling me earlier today that you have been working on change, positive change in the United States for more than a couple of decades.
That's true.
And some of it has really happened in a way that you might not have predicted when you were involved in Freedom Summer 1964. So, and you also seem to have a very sunny attitude towards the future in terms of thinking that it will work out and that our combined efforts, even though you can't see exactly how the stew is going to be made, the stew itself will be very tasty and will work out just fine. So would you comment on that? Because I think a lot of times when people are talking about energy and looking at the political fights and the very emotional charged jargon that people use can get kind of down in the dumps, which you never seem to do. So would you explain how you do that?
I mean, what is it that I'm drinking?
Or smoking.
All right. First of all, the conversation that we were having earlier today when I was trying to get you to tell me what questions you were going to ask me, I did mention that some of these battles take what seems to be a very long time, and yet in the span of history, it's actually pretty short. And I was referring to the fact that we're 50 years from the summer when, as a college student, I and a lot of other people my age got involved in voter registration and what seemed to be an intractable and, in those days, very dangerous effort to try to bring some degree of justice and equity into our country in terms of all of our citizens being able to participate in the political process. And yet, 50 years later, even though we've made tremendous progress in terms of elections and people of color being in elective office, as well as making other strides in the society, we're still seeing backlash in the form of efforts in various states to actually suppress voting and to roll back voting rights in elections. And so you could say, well, that means we didn't really succeed and not much happened. Or you could say we succeeded to an enormous extent, more than we really imagined in those days. And yet it's not totally won yet. We still have, you know, some work left to be done. Well, the case of energy policy, it's even more complicated than that, probably. It's a little harder to portray it as a matter of simple justice. But I do think when it comes to the right to breathe clean air, there is a pretty broad recognition that we don't have the right, those of us living here today, in order to maintain our lifestyle, to force people who live on small islands in the Pacific Ocean or the Indian Ocean to abandon their homes or to live under the conditions that, you know, climate change, if it goes above the 2 degrees that seems to be defined as safe, are going to bring upon us. And so it becomes an issue that I think engages a lot of people, including businesses as well as students and activists, in trying to solve it. And I do have a certain amount of faith based on what I've seen and on what I think is going on, that this is a problem that we can deal with.
So our time is really up, but I would like to say this. I think that Mary is the proof that one person working very diligently over an extended period of time, but also very intelligently and wisely, can make an immense difference. So I think we should give her a huge round of applause.